It's not the day to die from the bottomless pit. Won't you help to sing these songs of freedom? 'Cause all I ever have, redemption songs, redemption songs, redemption.
To understand how the encounter between the new world and the old has developed, you have to go back to where it began. The most beautiful thing in the world, Christopher Columbus called the island, the paradise of God. Here I will dwell, and here I will be buried. Of the inhabitants, he said, there are no better nor gentler people, who refuse nothing they possess if it be asked of them. But for some descendants of Columbus who live there now, the paradise of God has become a hell on earth. These Dominicans are about to embark on their own frightening voyage into the unknown. And you can trace the reason why back through the history of what has happened here since Columbus arrived. The Spaniards were the first of many waves of Europeans who settled in the Caribbean. Each wave left its own mark upon the islands, some deliberate, some accidental, like Columbus's arrival in the first place. When Columbus landed on the island, he had little idea where he was or in what direction he was headed. He was still convinced he was near to Chipangu, Japan, and that his next landfall would bring him to India and the great Khan, to whom he bore letters from the King and Queen of Spain. The Indians kept pointing him southwards, and he was anxious to press on. But on Christmas Day, 1492, his flagship, the Santa Maria, ran aground on the northern coast. From the timbers which he salvaged, he built a fort. He called it Navidad, Nativity. Then he sailed for Spain, leaving behind a small and doomed garrison. On his next three voyages, Columbus returned to the island. On each voyage, he brought more settlers, second sons in search of fame and fortune, or convicts pardoned on condition that they never returned to Spain. It soon became clear that the Spaniards were here not just to explore and convert, but to conquer and colonize. On his third voyage, Columbus sailed into Santo Domingo Harbor. It became the first Spanish city in the New World, echoing the grandeur of Seville from where they sailed. Here was a dazzling array of New World firsts. The first hospital, the first university in 1538, the first court of law, and the first Catholic cathedral. With these monuments of Spanish building came a whole Spanish way of life. Both have lasted to this day, but like fossils in a changed world. Jenny Ruhia's 15th birthday, her quinceañeros, is being celebrated by this Dominican family in pretty much the way it would have been celebrated at the court in Spain. The legacy of Spain survives in the Caribbean in societies as different as Castro's Cuba and America's Puerto Rico. But here, among the middle class of the Dominican Republic, it's at its most pure. By tradition, her first dance is with her father, whose wealthy legal practice has given her a start in life few in her country can afford. You can see in this a mirror of those early days when a few settlers got rich, but most stayed poor. Amid the grandeur of the Spanish palaces, I find it easy to forget that this island was originally just a staging post to somewhere else. They may have built great buildings in the name of God, but they created no real society. After all, that wasn't their objective.
The conquerors of the island, which they renamed Hispaniola, Little Spain, were not driven by religious zeal alone. They carried the cross of Jesus, but they had more materialistic things on their minds. The lurid tales by Marco Polo of treasure and spices in the East had lured Columbus across the Atlantic. And on the day after he first set foot on land in the New World, he confided to his journal, "I took care to discover whether the natives had any gold." The official currency of Dominica is still the peso oro, literally a weight or measure of gold.
The Dominicans are proud of Columbus. They insist that his remains are buried by the cathedral's fine west door. Outside in the cathedral square stands a statue to the great navigator. But it's a monument to Spanish treachery too. Anacaona, the beautiful queen of the Taino Indians, was rewarded for her hospitality with death by hanging. The sad fact about the Spaniards is that they wiped out the people who welcomed them ashore.
Decide with what justice you hold the Indians in such cruel and horrible servitude. Are they not men? Have they not rational minds? As early as 1511, there are churchmen speaking out against the treatment of the Indians. And yet within two generations, the entire Indian native population was wiped out. Some 2 million, it's estimated, were exterminated, worked to death in the mines and the fields, or infected by the diseases which the conquistadores brought with them. The Indians were dispensable, and when there were no more of them, they were easily replaced by black slaves from Africa, shipped in to work on the new sugar plantations.
The Dominicans of today are the product of this Spanish settlement. In the faces of the crowd following the Virgin statue, I could find a trace of everything in the island's history. Spanish Catholics, African slaves, and mulattoes. Everything, that is, except the Indians who lived here first. They were obliterated, disappeared, to borrow the language of another time, once they'd outlived their usefulness.
It's poignant to recall that the hands that quarried and shaped the stones of this, the first Catholic cathedral of the New World, were the hands of the people of Anacaona. The Indians to whom this New World belonged have left few traces behind. They're remembered now only in a few place names and in the echoes of their lost languages in words like canoe, hurricane, and yucca.
But there are some people here who say they sense other, less prosaic, traces of those tragic ancestors. In the remote western part of the island, there is a sacred compound revered by believers as the place where the spirit of that murdered Indian queen lives on.
Anacaona, cuidan a todo mi familia, mi hija, a todo. Cuidan a todo, Anacaona, la reina.
This old man invokes Anacaona, queen of the world.
Recibe esta visita que vino.
He asks her protection for his family, his children, for everyone.
Si, ella habla conmigo, yo hablo con ella, y ella cuando...
Anacaona comes to him in his dreams, he says, and talks to him.
Yo estoy hablando con ella, y ya ella hablando, esto, y esto, y esto, y esto, me dice.
His mother once saw the goddess queen, he says. Anacaona was singing, dancing, washing, playing with a ball. He prays that everyone may be well. And if you ask him what she looks like, this benevolent queen of his dreams, he has lots to say.
Ahí está. Tiene eso ahí pintadito, collán. ¿Tú la viste?
Her lips, for instance, are painted, and she is very beautiful.
Lo que se le ponen la mujer, ahí es. Y tiene collán, ¿tú la viste ahí? Y ella, así como yo la tengo retratada, así ella bonita con el pelo ahí. Ella le da el pelo ahí.
And she dances, and he dances with her to bring down blessings upon the world.
Yo sé bailarlo. Yo lo bailo, pero entonces allí no lo tocamos. Yo iba a bailar contigo allí. Que iban a bailar esos palos.
To this old man, Anacaona is a living deity who brings protection, and joy.
Allí, pero no tocan.
Bien, bien.
No quisieron los hombres tocarlo.
Why do these people of such mixed ancestry come to dance at the shrine of an Indian queen? It's not that they're Indians, of course, though some, I suppose, could have traces of Taino blood. It's because they want something to identify with which was not born of colonialism or slavery. And the Tainos were here before both. But it's easier to reinvent your history than it is to change your very character. The heritage of Spain now runs through their blood, and it has a violent streak. Every day, Julio Giraldez inspects the birds in his aviary. These birds are not for the pot. They're not for fighting, exactly. Giraldez is looking for something special, and he's found it. He farms cockerels for their spurs. The spur, extracted, honed, lacquered, and sharpened, is a deadly weapon in the cockpits. In time, new spurs will grow. Each new set earns thousands of pesos for a spurrier like Julio. Cockfighting is a great national sport. It rouses passions. And in a country where men carry guns, the audience has to be disarmed as a safety measure. Like bullfighting, it's an integral part of the culture of masculinity, machismo.
Entonces, el hombre de campo, machista en sí, ha visto en el gallo un símbolo de valor incomparable, porque no hay en nuestro conocimiento un animal que reúna las dotes de valor que reúne el gallo. El gallo de calidad, de pelea, no vence su espíritu hasta que no muere.
Plucked and dyed, the cock is ready to play the surrogate for his master's virility.
Pueden recibir golpes terribles, golpes mortales increíbles, pero nunca muestra cobardía. Entonces el hombre de campo lleva a la gallera su gallo para demostrar que él crió algo valiente, que él es sinónimo de él mismo, que lo está representando y que como él ante nada tiene miedo. La palabra gallo se le ha querido dar un sinónimo cuando en la República Dominicana le dicen que usted es un hombre gallo. Se le dice que usted es un hombre que es capaz de dominar a sus adversarios y de dominar no a una mujer, dominar cuantas mujeres se nos postren, cuantas mujeres tengamos por delante. Entonces, es sinónimo de entereza y de sexualidad.
Columbus brought fighting cocks to Hispaniola on his second voyage to entertain his sailors, for this was always the sport of the poor. The bullfight went to Mexico because that's where the rich went. But it's the same powerful brew: blood, sex, money, and sudden death. The odd thing is that Julio Giraldez is a qualified vet.
Realmente. Hay que reconocer que hay crueldad en la pelea de gallos, pero yo considero más cruel, y así consideran muchos de mis amigos, que dos humanos se peleen, se golpeen entre sí y lleguen al punto de matarse, como es tan común en el boxeo, o al final de una vida productiva de muchas peleas quedar tarados mentales. Entonces, ¿dónde está la crueldad? ¿Entre las riñas entre animales o en las riñas entre humanos?
Julio
todo es relativo, todo es relativo, y es una cuestión que no es más, como yo digo, nuestra cultura no es peor ni mejor, es diferente.
Different it certainly is. A mere sport it certainly is not. These men have too much of themselves invested here for it to be a simple pastime. For them it's a metaphor of conquest.
Entonces en nuestro medio, el hombre latino también, que como en otras ocasiones he dicho, no dispone a veces de los entretenimientos que son propios de la civilización, utiliza con mucha frecuencia, al igual que en España, no absoluto, porque hay muchos casos en los cuales no son comunes, por ejemplo, es mi caso, yo no lo utilizo, que dispongan de, o realicen, tengan relaciones extramaritales, y es muy común encontrar, muy común, personas con 2, 3, 4 queridas, 5 queridas, hombres no necesariamente de niveles económicos altos. Es muy más común tal vez en los niveles económicos inferiores que en los niveles económicos altos. Y es visto por los amigos de esas personas hasta como algo, como una muestra de machismo, de poder. Usted es un hombre que puede tener 4 o 5 mujeres, es un hombre macho.
Jaime Piña claims that his family came over from Spain with Columbus. Maybe that gives him special insight into what life is like now for the descendants of Columbus. Perhaps it's the Spanish legacy that's contributed to this spirit of every man for himself.
You know, a vehicle like this should simply not be on the street. This is probably a Chevrolet 60s, early 60s car. The reason it's so destroyed and it still can be on the street because traffic laws are not enforced here. Cops stops you on the road and you have no blinker lights. He won't give you a ticket. He'll expect you to give him 5 pesos. Everybody buys their licenses in this country. And the real bad drivers have never ever seen a driving instruction booklet, have never had their eye test in order to possess a license. It's simply bought within the bureaucratic system of a license issuing. You can't bribe your way around this country. Drug dealers go to jail here and 10 days later, they're out in the streets again, for instance.
All this gives the place a sense of life on the brink of anarchy.
I think foreigners, when they rent a car, they should be told, hey, listen, you have to stop also at green lights, because green lights is as dangerous as a red light. You have no right of way, even on the street where you have a right of way. People will go like this. That means I'm stopping in the middle of the street. Mirrors, they have one, is to look at yourself and comb your hair. Manuel, cuando tú puedas, trata de dar la vuelta en U y ponerlo yendo para la otra dirección. He's going for a U-turn in the middle of traffic. It'll take him a little while, but he'll get it. There he goes. His hands tells the guy to stop. And he didn't wait for it. Look at this, it's amazing. He just went for a U-turn.
Someone once said that the problem with Spain was that it behaved not like the mother of its empire, but its stepmother. And you can see what they meant. The country feels unloved and neglected. It was an undernourished child when it got its independence 150 years ago, and little has changed. Jaime Piña has been commissioned by the government to make a television film advertising the national lottery.
What's the magnitude of the box?
The idea is to fill the screen with fluttering peso notes powered by a jet of compressed air.
The bucket has the walls, and then watch. Dale.
Okay, okay.
Yeah. Okay, where is
okay, now it's got Andy. It's gotta be all over the place.
In fact, the people here need little persuasion to gamble on anything.
You could say it is a huge obsession. Everybody is expecting the easy way out, the way to get by in life without thinking about tomorrow and thinking that either you're going to win it, you're going to win 100 pesos today so you don't have to work tomorrow, or you're going to win 100,000 pesos today so you don't have to work for the next 6 months.
On the very quay where Columbus stepped ashore stands another symbol of life in the Republic.
The electricity situation in this country is certainly the best kept secret in the Caribbean. You come down to the real reality of the electrical situation here, I say power is on maybe 50% of the time. As a result of the energy crisis, you will notice an immense amount of stress among the Dominican. People that go to work in the morning that have slept all night without electricity, which means that your fan doesn't work, so the mosquitoes bite you, and then you wake up finally in the morning and you have to take your shower doesn't have any water, and you have to take a shower with a gallon of water that somebody has brought for you.
To find a way around the situation, the average Dominican has become an amateur electrician, and it's not hard to see the evidence.
Yes, you take a look at any sector, like this poor sector like here, they'll be privately tapped into the main source, the 220 volts that people wire themselves. That goes on, I'd say, everywhere in this country, the tapping in of the electricity. The people that want to make it better are too few, and the majority don't care. And that other piece are embezzling, are misusing the funds and channeling it into areas that are personal, that are not where they're supposed to go into.
Their own back pockets.
Or front pockets, or side pockets.
I was struck by how, in the heart of the capital, few people have their own water supply, and how the slums butt right up against the elegance of the old city.
The buildings of the old colonial city have been lovingly restored as part of the grand design of the blind octogenarian president, Joaquim Balaguer. But to mark the exploits of the great navigator 500 years earlier, the government has hatched an even more ambitious scheme, which they compare with the Colossus of Rhodes or the pyramids. This eighth wonder of the world is the Columbus Lighthouse.
The lighthouse is being constructed in the shape of a cross. At night, as an organ plays a Columbus requiem, the lighthouse will project through a gap in its roof an enormous cross into the sky, somehow surmounting, one presumes, the Republic's electrical problems. In 1992, the Pope and other heads of state would be invited to attend the long-postponed opening. President Balaguer, the project's great protector, has been around a long time. In 1930, he helped the infamous dictator General Trujillo seize power, and in 1978 took over himself. This monument will be the climax of his career. But his enthusiasm for Columbus gets mixed support. Does this cross commemorate the discovery of the New World, an encounter between two worlds, or the genocide of the first inhabitants? Ask the people who are unlucky enough to live nearby. Their homes are being bulldozed away to make room for it. First it was the Spanish, then a succession of dictators who have milked the country and neglected the people. Now they're meant to celebrate the great discoverer. Back inside the lighthouse, the architect is struggling against a fast-approaching deadline, which he must at all costs meet. Curiously, this is not architect Teofilo Carbonell's own design. It was drawn up by Joseph Gleave, an architecture student from Manchester, who won the acclaim of an international jury back in 1929. The building was started then, but Trujillo allowed the project to lapse because, rumor had it, he would be assassinated the day it was completed. Balaguer was confident enough to revive it only in 1986.
There has been real controversy about the lighthouse. How would you reply to these criticisms?
Todo en la vida constituye una polémica. Quizás es posible que se critique por el hecho de obra en sí, pero no por lo que ella va a significar en la vida de todo el mundo. Una mañana, yo muy preocupado le dije al señor presidente, que era el mismo presidente Balaguer, y él me dio una respuesta que todavía la guardo y la considero de gran importancia. Y él me dijo, Carbonell, a los pueblos hay que darle los zapatos, pero también la corbata. Si no hay elementos de cultura que satisfacen el espíritu, no el estómago solamente. Y esta es una obra que ha de satisfacer el espíritu de los dominicanos.
There's not much sign that the people living in these houses feel their spirits being uplifted. 7.5 million people live in this country, 1.5 million in its capital. One person in four cannot read or write. Infant mortality is 3 times as high as Cuba. The average income is just $15, £7 a week. And all this in a country which started out as the heart of the hugely rich Spanish Empire in the Americas.
Of all Dominica's industries, sugar is the most important and has the longest history. Columbus brought a bundle of canes with him on his second voyage in 1493. And sugar was replacing honey as the traditional sweetener. In Europe, there was a huge demand, and Hispaniola couldn't produce enough. The problem was labor, and that was solved by the Spanish system of repartimiento. Essentially, that meant rounding up the natives and making them work on the plantations. If we are to look at the survival of old Spanish customs, and if we are to believe the reports of human rights groups, very similar practices exist today in a country where the poorest citizen wouldn't be seen dead cutting cane with a machete.
Nowadays, most of the cane cutters come from Haiti, the Republic's traditional enemy in the other half of the island. There, the standard of living is even worse, and some of them come voluntarily. They live in segregated compounds like rural South African townships. These are the batets, run by the state and patrolled by the army. Thousands of Haitians were massacred by Trujillo's men back in the 30s, and today's Haitians have not forgotten. According to one civil rights worker who courageously broke his silence to speak to us, the Republic is still none too fussy about how Haitian cane cutters are recruited.
La forma en que es conseguida la mano de obra haitiana para cortar la caña tiene muchos rasgos de esclavitud. Es decir, hay trabajo forzado, hay secuestro de personas a veces, no hay libre tránsito. En todo eso hay aspectos de esclavitud. Sobre todo los haitianos que llegan nuevos, lo que llamamos nosotros congoes, de vez en cuando son sometidos a presiones para que no se vayan de ese batey, para que se queden en el corte y se les vigila. No decimos que es una cosa oficial necesariamente, pero sí un comercio con gente, un comercio ya reconocido y que el gobierno lo sabe también y aprovecha, sin embargo, esta mano de obra que ha sido secuestrada, traída de manera forzada, la utiliza para el corte de la caña.
The Haitians are also tied to the baté by debt. They owe the local store from the day they arrive, because they don't get paid for 2 weeks and must live on credit.
Me lo deben, lo venga, démelo, démelo.
Ah, como que tú te la bebes así, sí. Ah,
bueno. There's nowhere else to shop, though prices are higher in these stores than elsewhere. As the weeks and months pass, the shopkeepers' hold on their captive customers grows tighter. In the end, as the song says, they owe their souls to the company store. The only consolation for the people who live here is that back home in Haiti, life would probably be worse. There's always been poverty in the Caribbean countryside. Even when the plantations were prosperous, little got through to the workers. What makes it painful are the contrasts. And in the Dominican Republic,